Now I am requesting to our university librarian, Dr. Nimai Chand Saha, for the for giving the introduction about the our speaker. So Nimai da, please.
Okay, so very good afternoon to and my colleagues and today's speaker, Ms. Harsha Tiwari. At the very outset, let me just say, we are running our network trouble. That's why it is 3-4 minutes late to start the session. And I am worried about the conduction of, and or host of the sessions today. Because as you know, we are living in the rural India and rural belt. So every now and then, though our mindset is to be the digital India and digital society, still by virtue of geographic location and other infrastructure lacks, we are having some sort of problem. So I think you all will be understood our problem and bear with the situation. Now, just let me say, like two earlier sessions, it's the mid session of our five Viswarathi Library Network third national webinar 2020. And the third webinar, the topic is Gandhiji, as instructed by UGC MHRD and our university authority. I'm very happy to state that Viswarathi Library is a kind of confidence position of university administration. That's why this kind of holistic event we have been assigned to conduct. And as a part of that, we have already overcome our two sessions. First one is 31st of July, the topic of how to conceptualize Gandhi, which has been delivered by our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Vidyut Chakraborty. And today in the morning, another topic, that is second session, conducted by Madam Professor Asha Mukherjee, Registrar Acting and Professor, as well as Head Department of Philosophy and Comparative Religion. Her topic was Gandhi's Vaishnava Vedanta and concern for the other. And it's the time when we are just going to deliver our third topic on Gandhian idea of plural reconstruction under the MGNREGP of India by Ms. Harsha Tiwari, who's supposed to be a very serious and sincere research scholar of Department of Economics and Politics, Viswabharati. At the same time, she is also soldiering that responsibility of teaching one university as a guest, as a faculty in the Department of Economics. And let me just introduce, though it's not the kind of, you know, very well, still as a part of decorum, it's my duty to introduce the speaker before the audience. So very small introduction I'd like just to give before you all, that Harsha Tiwari is an assistant professor of economics at Amity University, Calcutta, India, and presently a PhD research scholar, as I told, in the Department of Economics and Politics at Viswabharati University, Shantiniketan. She had taught at St. Teresa's School, Makarampur, Bolpur, and as guest lecturer at BP Poddar Institute of Management and Technology, Kolkata, and Savitri Girls College, Kolkata. She has also worked as part-time research assistant for Professor Tirthankar Rai of London School of Economics. And she has also 6 publications to her credit and presented paper in 5 different seminars. She holds some other skills like professional skills, interpersonal skills, language proficiency skills, in addition to his regular MA degree in economics, since from class 10 to MA. And also she has successfully completed MPhil in economics from Viswabharati Department of Economics and Politics. And as I told, that today's hot topic is Gandhian idea of plural reconstruction and MGNREGP of India. So with these good few words, and as a part of my introduction, let me say, yes, this is Viswabharati, and this is the institute founded by Gurudev Tagore, where right from the vice chancellor to scholars to any faculty members, always supposed to live in the same family member where there is no differentiation from a vice chancellor, from a scholar, from a teacher, from a staff, from a faculty members. To address that legacy of Gurudev Tagore, and since we are all equal and same, that's why perhaps this is the first Indian university during this pandemic who are going to invite one such scholars. Of course, Ms. Tiwari, by her excellency, by her sincerity, we are capturing her name. Still, this is the broad idea, mission, and vision of Viswabharati to incorporate, to invite some of the new gen scholar who is supposed to handle the MG, NREGP as a part of that. And with this, we are just going to pay our homage, humble submission to none other than Jati Janak Mahatma Gandhiji. So let's enjoy our mid lecture, and tomorrow we'll have another two lectures. So please bear with, and a very good afternoon. And after having a lunch, our eyesight may close, because being a Bengali, it's our common nature. After having some sort of peace and other things, we are having this kind of problem. So with these few words, let me invite our today's scholar, Ms. Harsha Tiwari, to take her session. Now, Madam, floor is handed over to you for your speech. Madam Tiwari, please.
আচ্ছা তাহলে মানে নেটের কোন একটা মানে বড় শাটডাউন কিছু হয়েছে আমরা সব নেট মানে আউট হয়ে গেছে মানে লাইব্রেরিতে কোনো নেটই আমরা পাচ্ছি না আমরা ওই প্রাইভেট মানে মোবাইল থেকে কি হটস্পট করে চালাচ্ছে এই 3:15-20 পর্যন্ত হবে তার আগে একদম রাইট ছিল
হ্যালো হ্যালো हेलो हेलो सर एम आई ऑडिबल हेलो
विजिबल या यू आर ऑडिबल योर स्क्रीन इज आल्सो क्लियरली विजिबल
ओके थैंक यू
एंड या एंड बिफोर यू स्टार्ट लेट मी हैव वन मैसेज टू माय ऑल लर्नेड पार्टिसिपेंट्स एवरी सेशन वी आर सेइंग दैट प्लीज mute your audio and video to offer a good keep and silence floor to speaker so that our recording and all will be listening our speaker so please mute your audio and video and also don't make any chat box any regarding query or feedback link it will be given after tomorrow's session as we notify it The final feedback link will be given after completion of all the sessions. And if you have any questions, please put on the chat box. We will pick up the question and ask our speaker, and she will be kind enough to answer. With this calm and quiet environment, we like to commence our session. So please, I am already receiving some noise. Please, I request my host to. Yeah, I am also muting. So with these few words, let me invite and request our today's speakers, Ms. Harsha Tiwari. Now, Madam, floor is yours. Please start your deliberation. Your screen is clearly visible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone, for giving me the opportunity to speak on this in this webinar on Gandhi. My topic is Gandhian idea of rural reconstruction and the MG-NREGP of India. So we know who is Gandhiji. It's a very well-known person for our nation. He's the father of our nation and a person who has a very in-depth insight knowledge about the village scenario of the country. Because for Gandhi, according to him, what we can see from here is this, that he believes that for Gandhi, rural sector was the most important, and because he believed in this, that if the village perishes, India will perish too. So India will no more be India, her own mission in the world will get lost. For Gandhi, the most, so he has proposed for the development to occur in a very balanced way. Gandhi's main aim was on the development of the rural sector and in the non-agriculture sector. Because he knew that even in the time when Gandhi is going for this for freedom fighting and so on, at that time, he knows that the rural India is somewhere where there is overcrowding, overpopulation is existing in this agriculture sector. So as a result of that, the way to develop, to support the development of the rural areas will come from this, the development of the cottage industry. So he gives the idea of self-reliance, a comprehensive village. For them, charkha, khadi industry epitomizes and symbolizes the cottage industry, the development which comes through the cottage industry. So basically, you can see that Gandhi has proposed some 18 constructive programs. Among them, few were Swadeshi, village industries, labor bread, self-sufficiency, decentralization, equality, women empowerment, village sanitation, etc. Gandhi had this very clear view because he knew the fact that India resides in her villages. So the development of these villages is very crucial. But Gandhi was against the modernization because he had a fear that the revival of the villages is not possible only when it is no more exploited. So he believed in a simple thing that it was really very difficult for India to develop without cottage industry. So as a result of that, he was not against modernization, but yes, he was, his main agenda, his main focus was the development of the rural areas because there is deep-rooted poverty, misery in the rural India, mainly in the agriculture sector. So an alternative way, a parallel way of doing the development in the country would come in the hands of the development of these cottage industries. So you can see. But India, after independence, had adopted the path of heavy industrialization. And unfortunately, that fact, you can see that after adopting this path of modern industrialization, you can see from the 5-year plan, the second 5-year plan, especially the focus of the country was on the heavy industrialization. And if India had taken care, then it had only taken care of its agriculture sector. And we know that in the due course of time, India had adopted policies of the Green Revolution and also emphasized mainly was on the industrial sector. Somewhere or the other, one of the most crucial parts which was missing, that was development of village industries, were ignored. So, as a result of this, a part of rural development was missing. And as a result of the, what you can see in the time and again, you can see that there was misery, deepening poverty, growing miseries, deepening miseries in the rural areas. And this was shifted even to other sectors also. By adopting this pattern of growth by the country, a growth-led way. So, the Gandhian idea of becoming self-reliant, of a comprehensive village, was missing. So basically, let's have a view of a two-sector model. It's on one side where there is a traditional sector. You know that this traditional sector, and on the other side, there is a modern industrial sector. You can see in this traditional sector, there is overpopulation, surplus population is there, surplus labor is there. And what are the characteristics of these rural areas? The basic characteristics of these rural areas is that there is shrinking agriculture because there is already overpopulation in this sector. There are low wages, there exists disguised unemployment, which contribution, the marginal contribution of people is almost negligible. There is deep-rooted poverty, inequality in the society sector. So in order to search for some better jobs, people migrate from rural sector to modern industrial sector. This modern industrial sector is, these are the factors, the characteristics of the security sector are the push factors which push the people from the rural sector to the modern sector. Again, if you look, but the modern sector, why we go to the modern sector? Because there is a possibility that we will get higher wages. Then it's expected a possibility of higher income is there, but services are also available in this modern sector, so they might get from this business. But still, these were the pull factors, and you can see that still this modern sector is unable to absorb its all the its labor force which is coming in, and thus a surplus pool of population is left in a completely misery in such a, and due to the poverty, even we know that farmers, we know that even the farmers suicide is India, what is happening in the country, this graph reflects something that there is huge, that India, when it adopted this path of growth led in this pattern, migration and so on and so forth, because it had led to jobless growth in the country. This jobless growth, let's in this graph. In this graph, let us see what's the scenario of India and what is it. So we can see from here is this, that the employment, the growth is a growth rate of employment and growth rate of GDP. If you take into consideration the first time in year, that is between 1972 to 1977, we see that it's 2.6 in the GDP growth, whereas the employment growth is 2.6, approximately 50% is being converted, the growth has been converted for the employment generation. Gradually, when we move on, we see that in the year 1982 to 1986, we see that the GDP growth has decreased from, it has substantially a little bit, there is no such increase from the previous period, but yes, the employment growth is 1.7, which is not 50%. In the previous 2 years, in the previous decade, somewhere or the other, it had a growth of approximately 50%, but here it has reduced. This was the first thing which is very remarkable, which you can see. Again, in this time of between 1993 to 1999, is a time when GDP has increased to 6.8%, but the growth rate of employment is just 1%. There is this more than half has been decreased in this country. It might be that because during this time we adopted the new labor policy.
Madam Tiwari, yes. Please raise your volume a little bit. Because either voice ratio or it may be audio ratio a bit increased, okay? So that it will be listened clearly.
So we can see from here that in this period between 1993 to 1999, the country had adopted, during 1991 India had adopted the new labor policy. So maybe because of that change in the policy, it might have resulted to this decline. But the most striking year is 2004. Between this time period, between 2004 to 2009, when the GDP growth is at its height, at its peak, at GDP is growing at 8.7, but whereas the employment growth is negligible, it's 0.1, it's 0.1, it's so less. Again, if we take the last time frame between 2011 and 2015, then you see the growth rate is somewhere approximately around 6%. And we can see that the employment growth is approximately 0.6. Plus from here, we can say that the deep-rooted misery, poverty, jobless growth had devastated the economy, as well as because of migration, there was, as many other problems also, the poverty of rural areas had shifted to the poverty even in the urban areas, because urban areas also have a limitation, there is congestion, so it's not possible. So we can see a jobless poverty, hunger, everything. So just to overcome these problems, what the government can do? Government has made two backup plans. Among them is what? That we have a long history that India has, the government has to manage some of its adopting some development management programs outside this modern sphere, so that a minimum develop, so that a minimum support to the people can be given. So whenever there is this problem of unemployment, poverty, distress, misery, and to reduce the stress and misery from in the rural sector as well as to certain extent in the urban sector, because if there is constant migration, that might create problem in the urban spaces also. Just to reduce that, government tries to manage some development management programs outside the modern sphere, where some meaningful resources can be used and some development can be there and some livelihood support can be given. Basically, Gandhi's focus was not on the self-reliance and this, the development of the industry, the cottage industry as a whole, so that the development can be there. But what you can see from here, so you know, among there are different, so given in this context, government either go for the management program or they could have gone for the rural development by holding the hands of cottage industries. Among them, I will be speaking on the development management programs which are based mainly on the, for the employment creation. And among these programs, my focus area is NREGA, because we know that this program from 2009 onwards, this will be known as Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, as this is a program which bears the name of Mahatma Gandhi. So we will be discussing about this program more in details and more in depth. So here we know that in 2019, the name of NREG was changed to MNREG. Why this was done? This was done because to pay a humble tribute to the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi. Because you know this, what was the main feature of NREG? The main feature of NREG was that it is a program which works in a decentralized mechanism. Because Gandhi's idea was the development of the rural areas by holding the hands of non-agriculture, by holding the hands of, but yes, not exactly that, but by holding the hands of cottage industries. His main focus was on the decentralized mechanism. It should work. So that, because what is the characteristics of India? Its villages, especially a village in Himachal Pradesh, has a different characteristics than a village in West Bengal. So it's a, everywhere it's a diverse area is there. So as it is diverse, so definitely it will have its own problems, it will have its own solutions. So keeping that in mind, this pattern of decentralization was one of the main focus area of Gandhi. As he was advocate of this decentralization. Even if we take into consider, and what was the aim of MNREG? How is it implemented? MNREG is implemented at the grassroots level only, because at that grassroots level, the design of the program is in such a way that it works in a decentralized mechanism. So because keeping this in mind, so this program gets the name of Mahatma Gandhi. Now let's see what are the aims of this program. Aim of this program is to guarantee 100 days of employment. 100 days of employment generation is very crucial under this program, because we know that in Yes, we have seen from our few previous slides also that when NLRP was launched in 2006, if we remember that time frame between 2004 to 2009, the employment generation was negligible, which was just 0.1. And the GDP growth was at its peak. We know that actually a complete misery in the economy is visible. As this complete misery in the economy is visible, so this program aimed to give the minimum support of this 100 days of work. In a survey done by Ritika Khera in UP, she said in that survey report, it is written in this way that a villager is saying that if I get and my son get 30 days of work in a year properly, then we will be able to sustain. So thus this reflects what is the rural scenario of the country. So keeping this in mind, this beautiful program was designed, which is a wonderful program in its objectives and the way it is being framed. So what is this? There is asset creation. Its aim is asset creation, maybe sustainable also, but we will discuss about the sustainability or maybe the asset creation in the presentation. Then one of the objectives of this MNRDGP is increasing the agriculture wages, women empowerment, and upliftment of marginalized CSTs to reduce this distress migration. We have seen that because of this migration, there is lots of problem, chaos in the economy. So it was rightly aimed that if something is done in rural areas, it may try to mitigate some of the problems within the rural system itself, so that it doesn't add more burden to this urban areas. Poverty reduction is definitely one of the basic objective of the program by bringing more people under the financial one of the design. This design of MNRDGP is very wonderful because it is a demand-driven program, and this program is not like the other program, which is if a person who is willing to work under MNRDGP is willing to do some unskilled manual work, then the person can apply. There is a system of application, job cards, etc. So they can work under this MNRDGP. Everybody can be brought under this under the umbrella of MNRDGP, and so these people can get benefits of the program is expected. Now let's go to some of the let's see. So one basic question comes up, very obvious, is that a program which bears the name of Mahatma Gandhi, is it really based on the Gandhian idea, or what is it? Let's have a look at it. So first I will be telling about the coverage of the program. What is the coverage, how it's being done? So looking here, the coverage of the program, you can see a India map here. In this India map, you can see many red dots are. What are these red dots? Actually, these are those most backward districts of the country in which MGNRDGP was first implemented. This backward district selection was done by the Planning Commission on the basis of two criteria, on the basis of the poverty that existed in the districts and the population that existed in the district. So keeping this in mind, the poverty and population, we can see that in this 150 districts, along with more 50 districts, MNRDGP was first launched on 2nd Feb 2006 from Adilabad, a district in Andhra Pradesh. And then after 14 months, additional 130 districts were brought under the coverage of this program. And again, after 5 months, we can see that additional 266 districts were brought under the coverage of the program. And at present, under this program, there are 625 rural districts. Thus, it makes the world's largest employment generation program in terms of coverage. Yes. When this program was implemented in different phases, this was done. Many advocates, means many people, those who do research in MNREGP, some eminent names like Kritika Khera, Jean Derrison, they have said that when this program was launched, its implementation was quite a difficult thing because awareness was low. The people were not aware of the program. So its implementation in its initial years was quite difficult, but still, it's a beautiful, well-designed program, we can see. Now, let us see what is the performance of MNREGP in terms of the employment it is create. I have taken the data of this last 9 years from 2011 to 2020, so 1920 basically. So, what we can see from here is that that in the first 3 years, the number of percentages generated under the program is more or less alike. But only in the year 2014-15, we can see a decrease in the number of percentages generated under MNREGP. Again, if you look, the highest peak was in 2018-19, when the highest percentage was generated under the program. And eventually, you can say overall, over the years, there is increase in the percentage just for the year 2018-19. But the thing, see, in real terms, what is happening, if we see in real terms, that the total percentage created under MNREGP divided by number of persons worked under MNREGP, we can basically see that on average, this program is far from its targeted achievement and pace of work. Because we can see that on average, the percentage generated under MNREGP is not even reaching its target of 50%. And the highest percentage which was generated under the program was in the year 2019-20. In the year 2014-15, we see it was at its lowest, which was approximately somewhere around 25. So we can see here our employment generated, and it is just the 1/4 of the target what it was supposed to give of 100 days. So the program itself is detouring from its own objective of giving this employment for 100 days of work. Even in fact, it's not being able to complete its 50% of the target by giving people the employment for 50 days also. So it is detouring from the Gandhian idea also. Is it not? Let's have a look, because till now, because Gandhi's emphasis was what? Gandhi had said, according to Gandhi, his main emphasis was on a comprehensive village, on the rural development. And in that, he was a believer of the fact that there should be production done by the masses, not a mass production. So if there is production done by the masses, automatically that will generate employment overall. So you can see somewhere this program fails to generate something very fruitful from this person. Now let's look into the what this program is doing for the females. When considering this program for the females, we can see that this program really benefits females, because if you see in this graph which is given here, you see that the number of percentages generated for the females has increased over time, and it's more than that of males. Again, one of the feature of MNREGP is that there are actually two very crucial feature of MNREGP that really makes this program very much supportive for the females. First is that the aim of the objective, the way it has been designed, it says that the work has to be given within the 5 kilometer radius of the village. So a female which is residing, which is living in a rural area, sees that she has to travel less within the 5 kilometers of her home, she is of her village, she is getting work, then in that case she can do this work under MNREGP and then can manage her family, can do some other supportive work, work to family works which is needed. So this, because females sometimes they don't prefer to travel so much, too far. So for that aspect, this is a wonderful program that supports the, that encourages the female participation under the program. This one point is very essential. As well as one more thing is there, which is said that this is there in MNREGP, that it has taken, has really taken care of the mothers by taking care of their emotions and their feelings in the way that if a mother wants to work under the scheme, it can carry her child, can leave the child near the work site because there are special facilities given to them. In usually it is there are some certain facilities like Anganwadi and some other child care facilities are there where the mothers can leave their child, can go for the work, whatever they are going to do, they can work and then they can come back. And when female participation in this program is happening, it brings self-confidence, it gives them women empowerment, it gives them that rights that they can at least support support their family and so on. So we can see this female participation is very high under the program. Even according to the Gandhi, this is very important because Gandhi has said that females are the companions of male. They are no way lesser than males in their mental capabilities and so on and so forth. Thus, we can see from here that, and one more thing very crucial, which is there is no wage discrimination between male and females in this program. Both are paid equally as per their work. Same wages are paid to both male and female. So you can see here that this program really supports female, and Gandhian idea, you know, it's based on morality, it's based on ethics, and that is also being taken much care of by the people. So this is then, okay, now let's have a more discussion about the relationship between the asset created and fund utilization. This is something very interesting because something is very interesting to see, you know, in this, through this one graph, is that you can see there are two lines. One is a line which is reflecting the fund percentage of fund utilization under the program, and the second line, the blue line, which is indicating the asset creation under the program. Now when we look into this line diagram, we come to understand that the highest peak for the fund utilization was in the year 2008-09, and after that, from 2010-19 has declined. There was a minor fluctuations was there in 2010-11, but after that it is showing almost a constant or a constant trend. Yes, one more thing which I should mention, this is the real expenditure which I have taken into consideration. And on the other side, when asset creation is there, the asset creation was at its peak in 2010-11. Then again, 2011-12, once it has gone down, then there is almost a downward trend is there, and it is almost in a way that either it's downward trend is very constant, very minor. It's almost a constant, something like that. some minor fluctuations here and there, very minor fluctuations. So, but why this decrease after this, this time of 2011-12? This is a question which comes up to our mind. So it might be that maybe the rural activities which are done under MNREGP has come to a saturation point, because now there are no means, there might not, it is the thing that they might, the because if you look into the thing that it is that there is no more land left where still the pond cutting can be done. There is no more land left for digging some wells, taking care of tanks, so on and so forth. So basically this program comes up, well, there is no more space left for the rural activities to take place. So this we can see. Because why again? So in this way, somewhere or the other, it is deterring from the Gandhi model. If this would have been based upon just something was to be based upon the Gandhian idea, then just after a few years, this saturation may not have come. Now let's move further on the discussion. Let's see what happens in the future. But let's see what happens in the due course of time of our discussion. So if we categorize the different types of work completed under MNREGP, then we can see, yes, this mainly we can give the broad heading in five, in broad subcategory. We can categorize into broad five, under five headings, this the work of MNREGP. What are they? What, how can we see? It's that. Then from all these, what are the works which mainly MNREGP takes into consideration? Disaster management works, then water management works, irrigational, agricultural infrastructure works where irrigation has a pivotal role to play, then rural infrastructure, roads, then agriculture support activities by land development, and so from this, the commonality among all these graphs under this five heading is that it has a peak in the year 2010-11, and after that you can see a downward trend, a decreasing trend is visible. Maybe because the saturation, we have discussed in the previous slide also, that saturation. So there is, works are there. It's not that it is not there, but it is decreasing. It is ecologic, it is always decreasing throughout. So that's why you can see a decreasing trend. Now, so this gives us some idea. So there is a need of paradigm of shift is needed under MNREGP, because with these 10 activities, these are basically the activities under MNREGP which was done till 2013, from 2006 to 2013, these were the 10 activities which were done. So there is a need of this paradigm of shift, because you can see a saturation point is coming somewhere like this. Now, the programs were taken consideration after 2014 are like rural sanitation, drinking water, rural infrastructure, coastal areas, food grain, work on individual land, afforestation, playground, and some other rural activities which were approved by MI. So what you can see basically, this paradigm shift is there, but again two things which are missing in this way, that somewhere or the other, if we take into consideration, is that this afforestation is a very good thing. It was taken into consideration under MNREGP because this gives the support to the people by, for example, some artificial fruit gardens were made for maybe of mangoes, guava, etc. Then from those artificial gardens, it becomes a productive asset. And from there, these people can earn some additional income. So in this way, this additional asset, this type of asset creation was made. Some more things which is very crucial in this. So we have seen the paradigm shift of the program. Now, This is again a quote by Mahatma Gandhi, which is already self-explanatory in its way. In this quote, I have given emphasis particularly on the to grow its own food crops, reserve of cattle, playgrounds, on this ensuring clean water supply. Because just in the previous slide, as we have discussed, after 2014, these things were, these activities were brought under the coverage of the program. But the most important thing here is that what you can see from here, somewhere or the other, these the transportation, you can understand these were the Gandhi ideas, but still these were a very minor, very supportive ideas. These were there, but the Gandhi main idea or the main idea of this rural reconstruction was based on the cottage industry, which was based on the development of a comprehensive village, self-reliance village, so that it can attain. But somewhere or the other, this program is detouring from this Gandhian idea. Now, let us go into more in details, in more ground reality of MNREGP. How does it perform? What is the way in which it is performing? So for this reason, I have selected two villages. One is Mamodpur and the other one is Khirkundi of Hooghly district, but Hooghly of two different blocks. So let's first have the overview of villages. Mamodpur is a village which is a part of the block Dhuniakhali under Hooghly district. We can see the household here is around 195, and the male female ratio in this village is approximately 50. This village is actually a natural cluster of cottage industry, and in this village the main occupation of the people is weaving sarees, taat sarees. They are taatis basically in this area. And but what is the economic structure, what is the socio-economic situation of this place is that the people, the saris, they get a very low wage of around rupees 150 per sari, as they have to work all around for approximately 14 hours. So the, and from farming also, they are not being able to get very good returns. So as a result of it, they have to depend on MNREGP for their livelihood support, no doubt. A program which bears the name of Mahatma Gandhi is a wonderful program to support the people in terms of its livelihood. There is no doubt about the situation. Even under this program, under this in this village, what is observed that team participation is high. Definitely, as we have discussed earlier, also the teams are really encouraged to participate under the scheme, under the program. Again, the highest percentage generated in this village was approximately 72 days. Now let us have a overview of another village, which is Khirkundi. This belongs to the block of Pandu, which is under the Pandua block, and district remains Hooghly. What is the main difference between this block and the previous block? This Khirkundi is a village where the main occupation of people is farming. Mainly the Chandramukhi variety of potatoes are produced here, because this village falls under that belt of Hooghly district, where which is very much famous for its potato production. And there are some cottage industries like pottery dhapa, etc. The natural cottage industries, which are the inherent part of every villages of the country, those common cottage industries are there. Here also SC, STs, female participation is high and you will participate in the program. Here, up to 90 days, up to 90% days are generated under the program. Basically, what we can see that the social and this village of Kumbhi is more than double in terms of its population, in terms of its household size and so forth. So what we can see from here is that the socio-economic structure of the two villages are different. But the most striking point for me about the program is this, what are the type of work done in this program? The problem of these two villages is what? Misery, poverty is visible. At the same time, though there is a difference in the socioeconomic structure, but the problem remains the same of poverty, hunger, miseries, and all these things. Again, what we can take into consideration here is that the nature of the program. That is a very big question here. That in both the villages, we know that somewhere the characteristics of the villages are different. This is just an example which I'm trying to say, because we know that India is a country of diversified villages with diversified characteristics is there. So, but look into the program. This program works, the problem in Rajasthan and the problem in Bengal is same, because the works done under MNRGP is what? Pond cutting, those same disaster management, those same thing of afforestation, siltation, all these works are very stereotyped, very common. So basically, there is lack of creativity in this program, because every village or every states will have some or the other, because depending on their geographical location, depending on the socioeconomic structure, depending on their own way of development, every village or every state will have something or the other in a unique of its own. So as a result of it, but this program is what it is giving some type of homogeneous solution to all. Rather, it could have given some heterogeneous solution based on the problem of each and every village or each and every state in that region. Because this is, again, despite of the fact that this is a program which works in a decentralized mechanism, but somewhere or the other, the works which it take under is uniform. It's a stereotype. So what is happening? It is deviating from the Gandhian idea completely, in the way that Gandhi had said that development can come through the cottage industries, definitely based on that industry in which it is the best in its own way. So basically, from here, what I have understood after doing this, all these things, according to my simple knowledge, I understand one simple thing is here, that the plan is being designed on a decentralized way. But still, the solution, the work which is giving, it is something like a centralized. Because all of these are the activities which are need to be done, are very stereotyped. So this only these things can, these activities can be done, etc., etc. It cannot be done other than these. So as a result of this, the problem which is coming up, again, this is working in a way of a centralized mechanism somewhere or the other, despite of the fact that more creativity should be there under this paper. Now, this is again one of the things from which we have seen it from this asset condition of the chief only, a case. When asked to the people that what is the outcome of the program, they said it's minus or it's zero. I said, why is this so happen? They said, because there is overemployment. So definitely, because if there is saturation to a thing, then automatically this will create problem, because more things is a more type of activity, more type of thing which will support the rural development is now missing. And so this reflects the situation of the village and how much people depend on this program. One of the here I would like to say is, so these are some works which are done in different villages and so on. One more most crucial point about this program is this, that we have said about the screen that it works despite of based on some decentralized mechanisms, some other idea, but it is working as a decentralized in a stereotype of manner in a way in which it is doing. But one more thing is that not everybody should, but any development program can never give identity to the people. Because when we were, because it's in a general way, a sheep, a person who is into some sort of cottage involvement. For example, the people, those who are working in Mammoth, they say themselves, we are sheepies. The people, those who are working in this community, they say themselves, we are chashis. Because that occupation gives them the identity that yes, we are chashi, yes, we are shilpis, we are tatis. So this shilpis, this honor to be a shilpi, or basically that identity, yeah. No development program gives this identity to the people, because they cannot say that we are MNRDGP workers. So this comes up from here, that so we can say, so why can't this program be designed in such a way that it will help the occupation of the people which they are working into? It will support the development of the cottage industries, or it will support the development of the agriculture. Thus, you can see from here is that so MNRDGP should be designed in such a way that it helps in the development of rural infrastructure based on promoting the cottage industry. So if the people do whatever work they are doing, they get the support from their own work to basically uplift the rudimentary, the indigenous cottage industry which is existing already in the country. We know that Shantiniketan itself is a natural cluster of rural industries, cottage industries. Again, Patipara of Bibhu, Bhumiakhali of this Hubli district, Lucknow, very famous for its chicken work, Kalol, Mehsana, very much famous for its work on cotton. So if I start saying this is a huge list where there are, we know that this country is full of its own indigenous cottage industries. So there are already these natural clusters are already existing. So this program can adopt more varieties. It can bring some variation in its own self, so that it can support the rural, so that it can support these cottage industry, and thus a development can be seen and through this program. By holding the hands of this program, we may expect to see some development or reconstruction in the rural areas. So in this COVID situation, this pandemic crisis all around the country and the world, when we can see in the context when there is diverse migration is happening from urban to rural villages, MNRDGP can definitely be a very big tool, a very big measure, which can provide employment to the people in their home states. The people, those who are traveling back to their home states, can be employed through the scheme under the MNRDGP activities by supporting or by uplifting the cottage industries. But once this program has somewhere, so basically what we have seen till now, somewhere or the other, this program had it has detoured from the Gandhian idea. But we should not forget one. The last thing which I would like to say from here is this. We should not forget one thing about this program. It is a very wonderful program. It has a huge potential still to transform this rural India into a much better India, fulfill the Gandhian vision of self-reliance, self-sustainability, a comprehensive village. Can come through still by a bit change in the MNRDGP by bringing more variation by bringing more paradigm shift and increasing more employment under the program. Thank you all. Thank you, my audience, for listening me so patiently for so long. I would like to thank to my guide, Shomoda, and to my friends and other colleagues, those who have really supported me for doing this work throughout. I'm very much grateful to my friends and my colleagues for their valuable suggestion. My special thanks goes to my friend Shomnath Ghosh and Prateek Da. Without him and without his support, this wouldn't have been possible. Thank you all.
So, thank you, Madam Tiwari, for your nice brief to the point. I can even say concise, based on your field survey or research experience. You are not saying something based on literature and other things like quotation and many things. Still, your presentation is basically recycling on your practical experience, whatever you have witnessed in the rural villages of India, particularly Bengal, and in the light of MG NREGP, and of course, the philosophy of our Jati Janak Mahatma Gandhi. So I think presentation is able to reach our audience. So let me extend on behalf of the audience and on behalf of the Vishwabharati, on behalf of the Vishwabharati Library Network, and on behalf of the, of course, host, let me extend our warm regards to you for your nice and briefing presentation. Now, let me bring you 2-3 selective questions you to pay your attention. And before that, let me request you to close your screen share so that it will be helpful to me. Yes, first question to you. The question is, the question is from Saswato Bhattacharya. The question is a bit tricky to me. I don't know how can you handle the question. Still, since you are the speaker, let me directly throw the question for you. Ma'am, how much corruption among the local level leaders and fund leaking affected MGNREGA programs? And was there any adoption of Tagore's Shriniketan model of creating self-sufficient villages? Am I repeat?
Yes, sir, please.
The question is, ma'am, how much corruption among the local level leaders and fund leaking affected MGNREGA programs? And was there any adoption of Tagore Shriniketan model of creating self-sufficient villages?
Okay, sir. Thank you for the question. If regarding corruption, I can say Hello?
Yes, please continue.
Okay. Regarding corruption, I can say just this much, that we know that there is corruption involved. The places where I have been, I have not witnessed some leakages are definitely there. But still, to that extent, it's very difficult to assess what is happening, that how much corruption is there or not. Despite the fact, you know, to a certain extent, there is corruption and it is getting affected under the scheme. But again, the corruption, the fund leakage which this program has, it is not in a traditional way in which we know the system, which is the type of corruption system, which is here in a different manner, which is not actually definitely it's a correction, but it is, we cannot say in the way that it is affecting the implementation of the program. Like one small example I can share from my own survey, we have asked somewhere of the people that do you get money in time? They said, yes, we get money in time. So they said, do your supervisors take job cards and They say no problem like that, but still in return, as they take care of our things and they know how to manage our things, so for that is out of our we try to support them through some monetary ways, etc. So it's very difficult for me to say that whether there is direct corruption or not. According to my places what I have witnessed, though there are huge number of literatures which speak about the corruption in MNRDG. And regarding the second question which was asked, that about the model of Sri Niketan was adopted in the villages for getting the self-reliance, basically I have no idea about this model was really being implemented in that way or not, so I will not like to see, I will not like to say anything about it.
Mobile hello
hello
all there oh ek din jhata jhatpat puye sala sal bad apne chat ene chilo
suni eske
ha dukhana utor plastic utor ventral ra sundo ekane jhata diye puchha puchhamro bol
hello
aunga
Hello.
Hey you. Buffy.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. Let me bring you another questions that from questions from Patralika Bhattacharya. Do you think the Gandhian vision of Indian agriculture can be achieved with digitization of agriculture, especially in post-COVID situation?
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for this question. So I believe that the Gandhian vision can be brought to an extent. How much this digitalization will work is really a question mark, because we know what the situation of the country is. The country is where there is utmost poverty, there is lack of knowledge. Still, there are people, those who are unable, they are not well accustomed with this digitalization. So when bringing this digitalization, when they are bringing through this digitalization, the development in the rural sector, it's not that it will not happen, but definitely it is not the Gandhian view. If you be concerned about the Gandhian, then the first villages must be, then they must be first self-reliant, or they must become self-reliant or independent on their own. Then only if they attain their self-sufficiency or self-efficiency, then only it will be possible for them to attain these things. And just given this COVID-19 situation, when this crisis is there, I think MNRDGP or the development management programs, which are already well designed, if they are better modified, then definitely the Gandhian vision of achieving real development can be achieved.
Yeah, what is the impact of MG NREGP in the wages of other works like agriculture? How it created an effect on market?
Oh, yes. This is a wonderful, this is a very nice question that we know that MNREGP guarantees certain wages, guaranteed minimum wages to the people when they get employed. So basically what happens in this situation when people are, in the rural people, when they can see that if this, when this MNREGP wages were higher than that of the agriculture wages, so people used to say that we will go for MNREGP activity rather than doing this agriculture wage, doing agriculture activities, because wages in the agriculture is lower than the wages in the MNREGP. Some very famous work by Indira Hirve, she has focused that, she has shown that actually a program like MNREGP actually gives the bargaining power to the people, that as it is a right, it gives a surety that people will get guaranteed livelihood from this program. Under this program, they will get some guaranteed wages, guaranteed work. So this helps the people to bargain from the agriculture. And so if there is bargaining capacity of the people in the villages, if it increases, then it supports, it helps in the development of, it supports that through bargaining, even the agriculture wages could be increased. And so we can see this, there is a positive impact to a certain extent on the agriculture wages of MNREGP. So I can't hear you.
Okay. Hello.
Yes.
Now another question from Vivek Tiwari. His question is, did everyone got the benefit of this NREGS scheme in rural area?
No, definitely not, because this is a program which works on the development management. It works a self-driven mechanism. It's a development management program. And how can everybody in the rural area will get the benefit? Because the thing is, the very design of the program is this, that it is a program which is based on the demand-driven in nature. So a person who is willing to work under MNREGP will apply for the job, that yes, I'm willing to do unskilled manual work under the scheme, and thus from there they will get the Gram Panchayat approve some activities. If they think they will give the work, so then only if they work for those stipulated number of days, then only the support will be given. Otherwise, why? It's not that, it's not a universal program that everybody will get the benefit. It's the people who will opt for the program to work under the program will only get the benefits of this program. They can get the benefits.
Thank you. Now,
sir, you are again not audible. So you're not audible.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Is GIS used in your field area? Asked by Kaushik De, student, Department of History, University of Kollani. Is GIS used in your field area?
No. Yes, I have used GIS for a different map, not the one which I have presented here.
Okay, so I don't think there is any more questions. Even if it is, what is asked me to come conclusion? Because this interaction, this question answering is a kind of prerequisite of any education, any research society. As I believe that research vis-a-vis education is a journey, not the station. So if there is no question, then we would have the education and the research didn't have any dynamic character. Since it's a dynamic character, so questions will be there. And every research put forward some research gap for the next research. So no research is the complete one. Every research will based on some hypothesis, on its quantum of objectives. To address the objectives, any scholars, any guide, just try to cover up the field area and other things. If anyone found that this ma'am's presentation or this research work might have any lacks, so please, my request to all of you, carry another or further research area to fill up the gap of this research, to bring up the complete works in future, to address the final objective of nation building from the Gandhi, from the government of India, through the through this MGNREGP. Okay, so because the aim of anyone's research is try to give a kind of positive conclusion and inference. So if anything gap, this is a kind of, and she is now anyone can contact with ma'am at Amity University, since she's lecturer, since she is working there as assistant professor. And also you can contact with Department of Economics and Politics, and by her presentation, she pronounced the name of her guide, that is none other than a very popular personality in economics and politics, that is Professor Soumo Chakraborty. So anyone can contact with them for the research and interaction and knowledge enhancement of the things. This 1 hour is the starting of the journey, not the conclusion of the journey. But by watch, but by passage of time, let me say, warm regards, warm thanks to our today's speaker through her 1 hour speech and 5 questions by another 10 to 12 minutes. She tries her level best to pay some sort of shed light on the topic of MGNREGP in the light of Gandhian concept. And I am very much thankful to my learned audience who are every time, this is our third national webinar. First one was 11 lecture, second one was 10 lecture, and this one is 5 lecture. And by end of this month, we are going to organize one more, that is library management system, that is subject specific, and the online teaching learning environment. We are going to take up one more session containing 5-6 lecture too. So this is a kind of, during this pandemic, to give the lifeblood of the education society, this Vishwavarti Library Network in particular, and Vishwavarti University in general, going to acculture, going to harvest the educational phenomena among the students, the academics, the scholars, all. And by this, we are just trying to conceal the depression which we are feeling and finding from this great pandemic, COVID-19. And you see, many a times I found that people are saying this kind of webinar is enhancing the digital divide. That's true. Every coin has two sides. Like this webinar may have or must have two sides. Still, we are doing these things not to enhance the digital divide, but to interact, but to involve ourselves within the education society, so that our depression will be lesser, so that we will utilize our time even in this pandemic, even in this in the house or work from home. We are to address something what I think we can just cater to another people through this. And you see, only because of this pandemic and this webinar, we are getting Ma'am Thiwari to incorporate us one of the resource person. So let me thank you all once again, and at the very last, let me warm my heartfelt gratitude to my university administration in general, my honorable vice chancellor Professor Bidhu Chakraborty in particular, and registrar Professor Asha Mukherjee in particular, for their administrative support. We are only here to conduct this kind of third national VVLN webinar seminar, and this could not be possible without helping of my two hands, right hand Dr. Tapas Kumar Das, who's supposed to be the deputy librarian and soldiering the Kala Bhavan library administration, and another fellow, my left hand, Sri Ajay Kumar Sharma, who is supposed to be the in charge of China Bhavan library and also additional charge in Hindi Bhavan library. They are taking, in addition to their routine job, and our university is preparing for NAC, in addition to their tight and busy schedule, they are taking this kind of responsibility to bring all together 5 sessions through the Cisco Webex platform technically. So On behalf of you all, on behalf of this session, I would like to extend my warm congrats to my colleagues, Dr. Tapas Kumar Das and Mr. Ajay Kumar Sharma. And finally, we will meet together virtually tomorrow 11 a.m. for our fourth lecture, which will be delivered by Professor Soumo Chakraborty, and fifth lecture 3:30 p.m. will be delivered by Professor Biswajit Rai from the Department of Bengali. So I think they will also bring to you another corner of Gandhian thought, which you will enjoy a lot. With these few words, let me say temporarily, because thank you is a permanent word. I don't want to say you all thank you, thank you, thank you, but temporarily, thank you all for your kind cooperation and listening patiencefully to Ma'am Theory, and also Ma'am Theory for your kind acceptance of Biswabharati's invitation and illuminating us with your thought-provoking research experience. And we wish all of your academic in your future course of journey. And I think soon we will establish you in permanent service throughout Indian University, and with your thought-provoking economic thought and others philosophy, India and any institute, any students, any scholars will be enlightened. With these few words, let me say thank you. Stay safe and secured within these pandemic days. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Okay. Okay. So let me request my host, put on your video for taking group photo. Those who are interested, please put on your video right now, and my host will take screenshot for your photo. Please put on your photo. Please put on or unmute your video so that my colleagues will take a snapshot from the screen. Please, may I request all the participants to unmute your video only, not the audio. Please unmute your video. Okay. আসছে তোমার ওখানে ছবি আসছে সব অন করছে আমার মনে হয় ডিসকানেক্ট হয়ে গেছে
সো Thank you all for your unmuting your video for taking the photographs of this session. So today now we are going to wind up this session here, and hoping for the tomorrow session. So you can join timely, and we have already sent you the meeting link on your registered mail. So thank you. Thank you very much.